In our last stop, we were at towards the base of the Hawkesbury sandstone, and we know that at 25, 30 metres below it, David reckoned the sandstone was still down there. That's about right in terms of its overall thickness. But this isn't Hawkesbury sandstone, that isn't Hawkesbury sandstone. We were at nearly sea level out there before. The whole of this sequence in the cliffs below us is in the Newport series, which is stratigraphically below the Hawkesbury. Now we're physically up above it, and we're now stratigraphically below it. Oh, how does that work? Well, where's the Hawkesbury? It's actually on the top of that hill. There's a tiny, tiny little bit just up there, just a few blocks of quartz sandstone, which is the base of the Hawkesbury sandstone. So if you draw a line from there, what, 200 metres above sea level, roughly, all the way back up into Deep Creek, you've got this gentle westward slope for the base of the Hawkesbury sandstone. And so that's where we are stratigraphically. So we've gone a bit deeper in the sequence, and we're going to expect completely different rock types. We can see that they're different from the rock platform down there on the next headland. Further across, you've got Long Reef. You can see that there's something different going on there again. On the left-hand end of Long Reef, you can see dune sand climbing up the cliff. Dune sand climbing up the cliff. Hang on. There's not much beach down there. If you look really carefully in the Movie bit of the headland on Long Reef, you can see that the rocks are dipping up and flattening off and then seemingly going down again towards the old surf club. Can you see a little bit of a curve in the rock structure there? That's in fact what it is. There's a very subtle fold and a couple of faults in that sequence, which when you get closer to them, they're much easier to see. And the purpley bits of rock there that we've got at that point are the Bald Hill claystones. And they're the same rocks as we have on that rock platform and on this rock platform down here where we're going to visit in a moment. So along the coast here, we're pretty much operating at the same level all the way in that short distance. When you go to the next headland down, which is way over at Manly, we're back into Hawkesbury sandstone nearly all the way up. So although we've got layer cake geology through the whole of the Sydney Basin area, it isn't absolutely flat, and it isn't without its structure. It has these gentle folds in it. It has quite a bit of faulting in it as well. And the faulting, of course, parallels all those joint planes that we looked at in the sandstone. And as I said earlier, that tends to define the shape of the cliffs and the shape of the creek lines and the plan patterns of the creek lines. The dunes. How the hell does dune get up on the top of the headland and around through the golf course? And there's dunes on the top of North Head as well. And North Head's entirely surrounded by high cliff. 20,000 years ago, sea level was 150 metres below present. So we would come here and we'd have been on top of a high hill looking out across a coastal plain which was vegetated and on which people lived for 12, 15 or even 20 kilometres offshore. Most of that coastal plain would have been sandy, because its sea had been previously been up here and gone back and been up and gone back, and so it's reworked sand and marine sand and dune sand quite a lot across that plain. And then from 20,000 years ago to 12,000 years ago, the world slowly warmed up, and from 12,000 to 6,000 years ago, the world warmed up considerably, the ice caps melted back, the ocean rose, and it came up at about a rate of about a metre a century, which is the same sort of rate we're currently thinking about in terms of greenhouse warming, and it pushed all the sand on that coast plain shorewards. If there was a lot of sand, it built a big barrier system across the mouths of the creeks like the Narrabeen Beach and dammed off Narrabeen Lagoon. If it only had a small amount of sand offshore, because it was mostly rocky, it pushed the sand up to the edges of the high sea of the present sea level and then formed beaches, and it blew it up into dunes and got it up as a big body of sand on top of North Head, smaller body of sand on top of Long Reef, and tiny bodies of sand further along on these headlands. This slope that you see here where the vegetation is planed off by the wind so nicely actually has a lot of sand underneath it, and that sand is blowing off the present beach up the cliff face into that vegetation. So even under today's circumstances, beach sand can find its way to the tops of the cliffs and actually form little dunes. Weird, eh? Now where did the sand come from? Came from the creeks. Deep Creek, down the hill slopes, into the creek, down through Narrabeen Lagoon, out onto the beaches, spread out along the old coastal plain, resorted and pushed back up and shoved back up in here onto the top of the ridge, and slowly it's going to road down the other side and go back down into Deep Creek. So we've got ourselves a whole cycle going around and around and around. How do I know that? Because when I look at the sand, I can see that components of it are always the same and can always be seen to be derived from the Hawkesbury sandstone. Let's start in the beginning on the beach at this point. the most recent sediments in this system, the stuff that's washing in and out on the beach here today. Some of it gets up above high tide mark because we've had bigger waves than usual. It dries out, it blows up there in a little bit of a berm or dune and gets colonised by vegetation. Some of it literally blows up the cliff, and you can see sand up on that cliff face over there in amongst the rocks. And right up on top of the cliff, John tells me there is in fact a dune up there above all the agave. So the sand up there could be very recent indeed, just blown up the top and getting trapped in the vegetation and not coming back down or not going off the other side. But of course every time it rains, a lot of the sand on that cliff face is going to come straight back down on the beach. Is it the same sort of sand that you saw in the creek? How's it different? It's cleaner, the colour's different. It's orangey, yeah. Not the grey sort of bit nasty looking in the creek. Well, that's reasonable to expect because this is washed well and truly by the waves, whereas the creek is carrying a fair bit of silt and organic matter coming out of the soil. So have a look at it with a hand lens and look a little closer. The mauvey purple bits are shell. The deep purple bits, and there'll be fewer of them, are echinoderm spine fragments. And you might, if you can find some, you'll actually see some of the structure of the spine with little sort of prickles on it. They survive remarkably well in the sand. So then you'll get white bits which are platy, which will be more shell. And that only leaves us with the transparent, hard looking stuff, which is quartz. Yeah. So you could guess here you've got 15-20% shell in this sand. Back in the creek we had no shell. Back in the lagoon we had 3 or 4% of shell, because I told you that because the cement works people were trying to get it. On the coastal fringe we get up to 20-25% shell, and you get the most shell where you have the widest rock platforms there and here and Long Reef and further up at Avalon. Go to Bondi, very narrow sandstone rock platforms, almost no shell in the beach sand. If you're clever enough, you can take a sample from the beaches anywhere along Sydney and you can say where it came from on the proportions of shell in it and the nature of the shell components. Freshwater or salt water? Just a little bit brackish. It's fresh enough to drink, but it's also forming these beautiful little stalactites. Look at them here. Stalactites of what?
Iron
oxides, yeah. So we've got iron oxides being liberated by weathering processes out of this rock column above us, precipitating in these little seepage areas, making these little stalactite formations. So over time, that can cement up a hell of a lot of ground. But it's a demonstration of iron oxides actively moving in the environment, and the thing that moves them is bacteria. It's bacteria getting into the act in this instance, causing the weathering, causing this accumulative effect. Now, somebody asked me about springs at Deep Creek. These are springs, but they're such nebulous sorts of things, so you sort of think, oh, what the hell? But on the other hand, they're also important. If you're an Aboriginal person and you came down here, you got great tucker all the way around the cliff, around the rock platform, cop in your canoe and go out there and catch a wave and catch a few fish or whatever. Plenty of firewood comes in the driftwood and so forth, but you haven't got any fresh water. So this is a good spot to camp. Where's the midden? Whole lot of dark soil at the back of the cave, scattered all through it, little bits of white, shell. This time all edible species, all off the rock platform. It's been badly eroded away and just about disappeared. It's practically gone, this midden. And the core of it are these huge boulders. This is where we get into the details of stratigraphy. Do the shells and the occupation layer sit on top of these boulders, or are they through the boulders? Now, you can't answer that categorically without actually excavating the face, because the shells, of course, erode and tumble down the slope, and from this appearance, it looks like they're all through it. But in fact, the answer is they're on top of the boulders. So the boulders had to have been shoved in there by storm waves. And then the Aboriginal people came and lived on the top of all of this. The shells in this midden are all the species we find around on the rock platform. The rock platform's only been exposed for the last 5 or 6,000 years. We wouldn't expect that midden to be any older than that, and it's probably quite a bit younger. So If the sea level got to here 6,000 years ago, these figures, I must emphasise, are a bit rubbery. It could be that the early stages of accumulation of sediment in this little cove was boulder beach rather than sand beach. Then slowly that stabilised, the sand came in, locked it out, pushed the sand out towards the sea. Waves break out there now as a norm rather than back up here. Aboriginal people came down, and because the rock platform gave them a great food supply and there was fresh water available, they camped there. But that's a remnant midden, there's not much left of it. It's the sort of thing that would be very difficult to actually conserve or preserve in any sense nowadays. It still has some archaeological merit if one was to excavate it. And I think, but I've never been able to confirm it, I think this one was excavated back in the 1890s by people from the Department of Mines, and a couple of skeletons came out of it. I don't quote me on that one because I've never actually confirmed that this is the right location. They were digging up skeletons all over Sydney in the 1890s, sticking them in the Mines Department Museum, and they're often unprovenanced, and so we don't really know where the hell they came from. And this could be one of those cases. And so the cave has been fretted out by waves even before the boulders were dumped into it. So it's a marine cave in which we now have a boulder beach, and on top of the boulder beach we have an Aboriginal midden, and in front of the whole thing we've got modern sand. So in a nutshell, some complicated stratigraphy in just that tiny bit. Now we need to try and work out, how did this sediment, all these rocks, what environment were they deposited in? Well, one of the clues you're all standing on. The ripples, can you see them?
Yeah.
Zunk, 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 zunk. And that bed there is the same as this bed here, and it's rippled all the way. They're ripples which are asymmetric or symmetric. Are they steeper on one side than the other, or are they about the same on both sides? I think we'll probably get two opinions on this.
Yeah,
and one of them will be right. I reckon they're symmetric, which suggests to me that these are wave oscillation ripples. The waves come in slowly, slowly, and just work their way backwards and forwards across that bedding plane, leaving the ripples in a symmetrical case. If they are asymmetric, they tend to be steep on the downslopes on the downstream side. So an asymmetric ripple tends to mean rivers. A symmetric river, a ripple tends to mean wave action. So it looks like we've got quiet water wave action. Quiet water because a lot of the sediments are pretty fine grained and the ripples are preserved. That was a day back in the Triassic. Just one tide cycle or some damn thing. And here we are looking at it 230 years later or something and saying that was a day, just like today, when it was mud and the ripples were formed, and then the next layer of sediment, these lots, were dumped on top of it.
Why does only one day?
Well, chance. Why did that one? There you are. Because then came a bigger flood event down the estuary and dumped a whole lot of mud over it and preserved it. Yeah. And the last action was on a single day. If that's a surface in the bed of a shallow estuary, we might expect it would have fossils in it. We might expect that some sort of animals would be living in it, burrowing in it. Things would be crawling around on the top of it, leaving tracks and trails. And on these ripples over here, you can see some funny little scratch marks. And some more, and another one. Something with big claws going across the rippled surface. A labyrinthodon, 1.5 meters, 2 meters long. Sydney's answer to the dinosaurs. We actually had some very nice trackway on a slab that used to sit on this, and it's now been lost, ruined, stolen, whatever, and these are the only remnants of it. And if I didn't tell you that, and cross my heart and hope to die, you'd never believe it. And you'd come out here and you'd see that and say, well, that's a bit funny, and walk on. A labyrinthodon, a four-legged amphibian about 2 meters long. We know what it was because we've actually got fossils of them. You can match up the trackway claw marks in better conditions than this lot. There, at the end of my finger, and another one over here, which is a bit harder to see. Another one here, and another over here. It's a brown quartz-rich sandstone, but the little trackways are filled with the next layer of sediment up, which is a darker brown, chocolatey-coloured siltstone. So it's been preserved as a cast. So we got our modern day tidal, intertidal zonation here. The barnacles running down to the serpulid worm tubes, over a metre and a half. Barnacles on that rock, it's in situ. Serpulid worm tubes on the top here, barnacles on the bottom, it's turned over. And that one back in there is turned over too. And up in there we've got some big slabs of concrete which have been washed out of this former roadway which was constructed in the 1970s. So these rocks are actively mobile. That not every year, but every time we get a decent storm, waves breaking up in here, these boulders actually move and we're on a boulder beach. And they keep breaking up and stuff keeps falling off the cliff. You'll notice there's a lot of debris along the edge there, so there's always a chance of little bits coming off even on a nice day like this. What's this stuff?
Fossils.
Fossils. Fossil vegetation. And in fact, we can be a bit more specific, fossil reeds. They're great big long freshwater or perhaps salty marine estuarine freshwater reeds called Philotheca. Bigger than seagrass, would have grown maybe 2-3 metres high. Take the big grey face in front of it with the water seepages coming out of it. Up the top, it's really fine and got some whole lot of finely laminated bedding in there which has got a bit of pattern to it, looking like little dunes and cross bedding. The bulk of it is more massive with lots of joint planes running through it. It's got a layer of boulders through the middle of it there and another layer of bouldery bits up towards the top of it. But the bottom of it is high there, dips down under the boulder bed there and comes back up again to the far end of that big water seepage, and the whole thing makes a sort of a lozenge or a lens. Can you see that shape? We're looking at a cross-section of a river channel. Now we've just been arguing that we're in an estuary when this boulder and with the ripples, but in that estuary there was a river nearby which cut channels through the muds every once in a while, and this is an example of it. A boulder of conglomerate. These are all ironstone. That's shale. And that is coal. A slab of coal, just a tiny little bit. The conglomerate is washed in high energy conditions. The ironstone's probably come with it. The porosity of that gravelly layer would be higher and more iron oxide would accumulate and a sediment in it. The shale has to have come as a big lump of mud, a slab of mud. So around here there must have been estuarine muds or backwater muds, probably desiccated and cracked when they're drying out, and when the next flood came down and picked up a slab of it, carried it into the middle of the channel and dumped it, and has now been compressed again and turned to shale. The coal, just that tiny bit with a branch in it at the top, and that little bit there, and that bit there, and that bit there, and I'm sure I can find more shale here. Don't see any more coal for the moment. The coal came in as logs around, load it with 1.5 kilometres of sediment, round logs become flat slabs, and so that's actually a preserved log now turned to coal. Come up and have a closer look if you like, or we can pick it up as we go out. Now we're on the Bald Hill Claystone, or the Chocolate Shale. You can see why they call it Chocolate Shale. In this boulder we got more of those funny cracks, worms. Here we got more of the blotchy bits, grey bits inside purpley bits. They tend to be circular and they look as if they're more or less vertical.
Burrows.
And there's lots of them over here. Grey bits inside purpley brown bits. And we can see it in cross section this time. Look.
Yeah. Worms.
Worms? Bloody big worms.
Vegetation.
Vegetation. Vegetation tends to branch down. If it's reeds, they tend to be horizontally layered to the root pattern. They're burrows, but burrows of something about centimetre or so across that operates through the sediment vertically and tends not to branch. Occasionally you see a branching one, but they don't. We don't know what they were. Worm tubes are the usual sort of description, but I don't think that really answers it. Let's just call it a burrow pattern. And you can describe its geometry and you can give it a name. This is what's called an ichnogenera, a trace fossil. And you actually do name the damn things. That one I can't remember the name of offhand. They haven't been fully formalised, so it doesn't really matter.
It is a footprint.
Yep, it is, yep.
Oh, so it is. Yeah, these, two footprints.
Yep, and so those are those, two. Oh.
What's the white stuff coming out of the rock?
I'm not sure. Yeah, I think it might be silica, but I'm not sure.
Why not?
We got a new fossil record here. It's not the one I was just looking for, which is, I'm sure is down there somewhere, but we might turn it up. We got a really nice footprint here. It's the same as the one on the rippled one, but those are the claws, and that's the handprint there. And he was wandering around in here, and these little disturbances are actually burrows of the type that I was looking for. These burrows are actually quite large. You can see the size of that. You can see the way sediment's been dug out of there and dumped here, and there's more disturbance there and there and there.
So tell me where the burrow is.
Well, this was the burrow in here.
The whole thing?
Yeah, the whole thing. So we've got a cluster of little burrows with something living in them, and the labyrinthodon coming along, 1 foot there, 1 foot there, and a whole lot of scratches over here, where he's sort of been either walking past or looking for dinner.
What did he eat?
Who knows?
That's what you might have found.
Probably Italian, I think. Yeah. You can see that it's slightly domed, and it's harder here than here, and so it's standing up as a little piece of relief as the platform's being eroded off. And that's all you can see of that, just a little pothole. And you wouldn't pick it as being a trace fossil just from that evidence alone. But when you saw them over there and you realise that there's big burrow features on this platform, you think, oh, maybe that one too. And then you come to this one and you can actually see that there is scrape marks in it here. So these are the claw marks on either end of these things, where it's actually been burrowed out by something we think like a crustacean, like a crayfish or something. So we're maybe marine, certainly estuarine in these units here, with lots of burrowing things going through it, some bigger animals living in it, and our labyrinthodon scuttling around on the surface, maybe looking for a crayfish dinner. Burrows here, going down at a bit of an angle into the rock. You can see the slightly different colour of that formation, and it's got some structural integrity, a little bit of scrabbling and scratch marks on the outside of it. So we're looking at a burrow this sort of size that something like a crustacean lobstery sort of animal lived in. We never find the animal, so we don't really know what the hell it was. The burrow has been given a generic name, and it's Taramedda ichnus. Good place for it to be, Taramedda ichnus, found in Taramedda. There. We got another slightly smaller one. This time we can see in it, and it's had some sort of hardening of the outer wall. Iron oxide's moving down, or muds or something that's disturbed. You can see the claw marks on it quite clearly where it's been excavated, and then it's been infilled with the grey sediment from the next unit up in those faces up in there. I think that's the one that I photographed. It's certainly on this platform here somewhere, and I think somebody's broken it off on that surface there. But a lot of people come fossil collecting here, and fossil collectors tend to be people with geological hammers that smash rocks up in the hope that every time you hit a rock a fossil will pop out. Well, you don't really need the hammer, you can find them without it. And I think it's preferable to leave them in place, unless you're collecting for museum purposes or something like that, so that other people can come and discover them as well. So our new trackways down there, the new little claw prints, great, but hopefully they'll remain. Somebody inexperienced is likely to come along and chop at them with a geology pick, and you can't get them out, they'll just smash them up, and so we lose them.